My name is Donald Tarter. I'm with the Sociology Department at the University of Alabama in Huntsville. And this is the fourth in a series of interviews that we are doing with the Fathers of Rocketry. We are calling this series of interviews Our Future in Space, Messages from the Beginning. Mr. Conrad Dannenberg of the Alabama Space and Rocket Center is assisting me in these interviews. And today our guest will be Dr. Ernst Stuhlinger. Dr. Stuhlinger is one of the most eminent people involved in the history of rocketry. Dr. Stuhlinger, incidentally, happens to hold one of the first doctorates in nuclear physics ever given in the world. He became associated with the space endeavors at Peenemünde, later came to the United States, to Fort Bliss, and then to Huntsville, where he served as Director of Science at the Marshall Space Flight Center, Associate Director of Science at the Marshall Space Flight Center until his retirement in 1973. At that time, he became affiliated with the University of Alabama in Huntsville as Adjunct Professor of Environmental and Energy Sciences at the Johnson Environmental and Energy Center. As of now, Dr. Stuhlinger is a research associate with the Teledyne Brown Company here in Huntsville, and he's going to join us today to give his thoughts about the history and the future of the space program. We're going to open this interview by allowing Mr. Dannenberg to ask a series of questions about the history of the space program. Mr. Dannenberg?
Dr. Stuhlinger, we just learned that you joined the rocket team in Peenemünde. Can you tell us briefly how you got to Peenemünde and what your first responsibilities were at that time?
During the war, Mr. Dannenberg, I was a soldier, as many young Germans were at that time. I was a PFC in the German army, and I was marching through the steppes of the Ukraine when an order reached me early in 1943 to come back and to join the Peenemünde group. At that time, I did not know what Peenemünde stood for. Neither had I heard of the name of von Braun or of the rocket program. That was a well-kept secret in Germany at that time. So I came back from the Russian front to Peenemünde and met at first Dr. Steinhoff, who told me about the program and about Dr. von Braun. That's how I came to Peenemünde and how I had my first contact with von Braun, at least by name.
I am sure it was quite a relief for you to get taken out of your military duties and to be able to do something else. Could you tell us briefly what your first responsibilities were and what kind of projects you worked on?
As a member of Dr. Steinhoff's division of guidance and control and electronic systems, I worked in that area. That had some relationship with my former field of physics. So it was natural for me to work in this area, and my assignment had to do with the development of small systems which could be built in a small size and put into the rocket, and which would measure the velocity and the distance flown by the rocket. This data would be used in the guidance of the rocket, and since these systems were carried on board, they would make radio connections unnecessary. They were called inertial systems or onboard systems.
And of course, this entire area was one of the major advances that were made at that time in the field of rocketry. The other one was, of course, a propulsion system. Propulsion systems of this type and this size had not been built before. And I think you can say the same thing for the guidance and control system.
Certainly correct. There was some guidance of that kind existing for airplanes, some gyro stabilizing systems, but nothing of the kind we had to develop with the accuracy, with the degree of automatic operation. That was all new. And also we must not forget today that at that time there was no microelectronics and no computers and no transistors. There were tubes, the old-fashioned tubes, which were little ovens actually because they were so hot all the time, and much of the time they didn't work either. But still we had to put them together and use them for our electronic systems, and by and large they worked.
Mm-hmm. Were you already in Peenemünde when the first successful V2 was fired in October 43?
No, that was in October 42. And I came in April 43.
Right.
In March, mm-hmm. April 43. Mm-hmm. So I saw the launching number 3 of the V2, which was the mm-hmm. successful one. That was my first launching mm-hmm. in April 43.
Okay, but you were not present when the very first one was launched at that time.
No, I was still out in the Far East mm-hmm. at that time.
And in spite of this very dramatic event, you had not heard about the rocket activities in Peenemünde, as you said earlier.
No.
So it was a very well kept secret.
It sure was.
Yeah. Let's talk a little bit more about the technology, about the guidance and control and the propulsion technology. There are quite some interest, and that's of course a reason that the U.S. Army brought the rocket team over to this country here. What is your evaluation of the kind of steps we have taken since coming over here? Have we made major progress since the times in Peenemünde? And can you again briefly outline your role in these events? I particularly seem to recall that one of your key roles was in connection with the first Explorer. So can you take us up to this time frame and tell us briefly what your thinking is in these areas?
The basic technology of rockets and even of their inertial guidance had been developed already by the time we came over to this country. We had used it for the V2, for the A4 rocket in Peenemünde. However, a lot of improvement was necessary for better accuracy, better reliability, for just more volume of guidance data and control data. And for this further development, it was necessary that on a broad basis, the whole electronics, art and technology, was developed further. For example, the computers began to be developed at that time in the early years when we were here in this country. And we can say in retrospect that a project such as the Apollo flight to the moon would never have been possible without the computer capability which we had at that time. We did not have that in Peenemünde, of course, and not at the beginning when we first came to this country. Mm-hmm.
Some people claim the entire computer technology we have today is to a degree really founded in the space program because it was needed there, it was a requirement to do computations real fast, and you apparently agree with this kind of evaluation.
I certainly do. The computer technology and science certainly owes a lot of its first impetus and supporting funding, particularly to the space program. It was not only the idea, the basic idea, it was also just the funding which had to, mm-hmm. would be available mm-hmm. for the development of such systems. And funding was available to a considerable amount at that time in the space program, and the requirement was there, the need was there, and so the two converged together mm-hmm. and we had a mm-hmm. good development.
Can you tell us a little bit more about the Explorer launch in which you played a key role?
The Explorer was actually launched early in 58 in January, but it had been planned a long time before that. The fact that satellites can be built and can be launched into orbit had been quite well known and accepted and acknowledged for at least 30 years at that time. The details had been quite well known, and proposals for satellite launchings had been made in this country and certainly in other countries also for a number of years. In fact, the first proposals made in this country were made, I believe, even in the first little studies in 44, even before our group came over here. Von Braun, of course, had talked about satellites, even in Peenemünde, very intensely. Then the beginning of a real satellite project was in about 55, when President Eisenhower established this country's participation in the IGY, the International Geophysical Year, and when he promised that the United States would launch a satellite in connection with the scientific investigations of the IGY. In 1954, a year earlier already, Dr. von Braun had submitted a technical report, a technical proposal to the Army, in which he proposed the building and launching of a little Earth satellite. This proposal was studied but not accepted as a development. When President Eisenhower established the project as a contribution of this country to the IGY, the assignment to build such a satellite was given to a civilian group under the Navy's auspices. That group was called the Vanguard Group, and Vanguard development was then started. I think the history of the satellite, the Explorer, and the Vanguard is fairly well known, and we need not go through it again. Anyway, the first American satellite was launched in January 1958, and it was one on top of a Redstone vehicle, which was built in Huntsville, Alabama.
Can you tell us a little bit more about the actual Explorer payload and what the payload accomplished?
When we began to build the satellite and put it together, in even long before we were formally permitted to do so, it was in 54, 55, Dr. von Braun had the idea that we should by all means have a scientific objective connected with the satellite. It should not be only a piece of inert matter thrown out into the orbit and going around the Earth, but it should be something that could do some honest to goodness scientific work. Mm-hmm. Now, at an early in an early phase of the satellite program, we teamed up with JPL, the Jet Propulsion Laboratory. The director of that laboratory, Dr. Pickering, was very much in favor of having a scientific payload on it. Dr. von Braun asked me at that time to look for some kind of scientific payload. At that time, I went to Dr. Van Allen, who is well known from the Van Allen Belts, and offered or proposed to him that he should participate in our project of launching a little Geiger counter that could count cosmic rays out there, that he should build one and put one on our satellite. Again, this is a long story which went through a couple of years and had its ups and downs, but the end of it was that little Explorer did carry two little Geiger counters by Van Allen, and they discovered the Van Allen belts, the radiation belts around our Earth.
I understand that Dr. Van Allen made already a number of similar flights on earlier V2 launchings, which were done from
the sense. Yes, in fact, we had met each other in 1946 while the von Braun group helped to launch some of the V2 rockets that had been brought over from Germany to this country for test launchings in White Sands in New Mexico. These rockets, of course, did not need to carry warheads, so they carried scientific instruments, and among the scientists who accepted this opportunity was Van Allen. He put some little counters on the V2 rockets and launched them and made his measurements about cosmic rays.
And he apparently had some inkling from these tests that something was going on in outer space
we
were not too well aware of.
Yes.
And
yes.
He really proceeded to measure it in some more detail with the Explorer.
The frequency of cosmic rays while you go up in altitude, the density of the radiation had been a kind of a puzzle to the scientists for many years and had been measured up to an altitude of before the war, about 26 kilometers of altitude, and then with the V2 up to about 100 or 120 kilometers or 150 kilometers. But it was quite strange, the behavior. And so when Ellen said, well, we should measure up there in an orbiter and should really see how this radiation behaves there.
All these things still took place while the Army was in charge of these kind of projects.
Yes.
And of course, in 1958, on a national basis, the National Aeronautics and Space Administration was established, and the local group here in Huntsville, later on the Marshall Space Flight Center, joined NASA in 1960, in summer 1960. And of course, one of the major accomplishments during that time was the providing of the big booster, the second booster, for the lunar landing. And you, of course, again played some key roles. Can you summarize very briefly what your responsibilities were in connection with the Saturn and the Apollo lunar landing program? And can you give us a brief history review in that area?
At that time, we had in the Marshall Center, among other divisions, one which was called the Research and Science Laboratory, Space Science Laboratory. That was my laboratory. Our functions were quite diversified. The main function was to support our mainline project, the Saturn project, with some scientific investigations, particularly with respect to thermal problems. And then, of course, there was the big problem, what will happen when we go to the moon and have to land there, and there are astronauts going around on the moon. So the question was, how is the surface of the moon structured? Will they sink into an ocean of dust, or will they be will they meet other unforeseen circumstances? So one of the things we did in my laboratory was to try to find out as much about the lunar surface as we could, to study it and to think of how a vehicle should be designed and built that is able to travel on the lunar surface, of which we knew very little at the time. So we went into a broad project of studies. We tried to get together everything that one could learn from astronomy about the moon and about dust from laboratory experiments, and we tried to find out how a lunar vehicle might have to be built.
Mm-hmm.
Well, everybody knows that our vehicle did work well. It traveled very well over the moon and did not sink into the dust.
Before we landed on the moon with the Saturn V, the big booster, which is on display at the Alabama Space and Rocket Center, we used a few smaller boosters, the Saturn I and the Saturn IB. And some of the earlier versions were particularly also used in order to make some micrometeoroid measurements. The Pegasus project, can you say a few words about Pegasus and what we got out of it?
At that time, the meteoroid danger in orbit was relatively unknown. One knows roughly how many meteorites hit the Earth. They are visible as meteors, as these luminescent streaks through the sky, and one could roughly estimate how many of these little grains, high-speed grains, maybe flying around above the atmosphere, but one didn't know really exactly how many there would be. So we decided in the Marshall Center that we would build a project to measure the frequency of impact of meteorites on a given area over some time. And the best we could do was to take our heaviest rocket at the time, which was a Saturn I, and to build a payload which had a sensitive area as large as possible, to fire the thing up, to keep it in orbit, to have an electric sensor system which would tell us each time when a meteorite hit the surface, tell us by a little electric signal, and even try to find out its magnitude from the magnitude of the signal. And on the basis of this data, we hoped to establish a kind of a statistical frequency distribution of meteorites in space. We had three launchings, and all of them worked well. The data which we received out of these measurements were extremely valuable for not only for the Saturn Apollo project, but for many other projects of satellites and space probes.
Did they indicate that there was a real danger from meteoroids or micrometeoroids in outer space?
One cannot discard this danger completely, but on the other hand, the level of danger is much smaller than some people had feared before. There were some instances, when we look over all the projects in space which have been done over the past 20 or 30 years, there were some instances where we think that a little meteorite had hit a sensitive part and had done a little damage in one of the rockets and its payloads, but it's not a real big danger.
Mm-hmm. That brings us then almost up to the lunar landing. some of the old-timers of the von Braun team believe that was a highlight in their career. How do you feel about the accomplishment of landing men on the moon? Do you agree with it, or do you think there are other things that are at least as important or maybe even more important than this?
It was certainly a highlight and a very brilliant event for all of us who had been in this program, particularly for von Braun personally, and of course as well for all the other many, many people who had been part of this program. In fact, when the Saturn program was at its peak, there were about 400,000 employees of the project in this country. 400,000, and each of them, all of them, of course, should feel and probably did feel very happy and proud of the success.
Mm-hmm. Can you think of any other major highlights, even up to this day, which would even come close to this?
There were highlights, of course, after that. The Skylab, for example, and a particular highlight of the Skylab was that we, or the group, succeeded in keeping the Skylab project alive even after this very bad mishap on its way up when one of the wings was torn off, the solar panels. It could be fixed in space, and the objective of the mission was fully met, which I believe was a very great accomplishment. Mm-hmm. It was different from the, of course, from the public impact that the lunar landing made, but it was a very important event for all of those who were involved. And then, of course, the shuttle was another one. The shuttle is a very complex machine, a very complicated machine. It has worked a number of times. We had no real mishap with the shuttle flights so far. We hope that it will remain that way. And this is also an accomplishment which should be ranked, I think, quite high in the sequence of events of the space program.
Well, I almost think this sums up in very few words, of course, the past history, and maybe we should now turn a little bit to the future. And maybe Dr. Tata wants to ask a few futuristically oriented questions.
One more question, Dr. Stillinger, before we leave the history of the space program entirely. 2 days before this interview, and incidentally today's date is December the 14th, 1984, one of your very cherished colleagues, Dr. Kraft Ehrke, passed away. You and Mr. Dannenberg both worked with Dr. Ehrke, and I'd like for each of you to perhaps say a few words about him and to put some perspective on his contribution to the program.
Dr. Tata, I had known Kraft Ehrke for 45 years. And I had always been very, very much impressed by him. He was, in my opinion, he was not a man, he was a phenomenon. He was so extremely active and filled with enthusiasm about space, about any kind of space projects, which was, he was in a category of his own with his enthusiasm and also knowledge. It was just tremendous, the amount of knowledge and capability he had in his head, and he could squirt out and produce. If you tipped off a little bit, you better took 2 hours because he just continued to talk and talk and present. And all he said made a lot of sense and was full of facts and of data. He was a phenomenon, really. He was very passionate. He was an extremely hard worker. And his resourcefulness in coming up with new projects for space was just unbelievable. He produced, I think he produced about a new project every month or so, and each of them was founded on facts, on engineering data, on scientific data, even on economical and political data. Each of them was a fully structured, it was not only a pipe dream, it was a full system worked out and thought out in detail. The tragedy was only that reality could not keep up with Kraft Ehrke. It would just have been fully impossible for any country or any earthly structure to follow in doing and manufacturing and building the many, many things which he proposed and which all made sense in their own right. As I said, he was a phenomenon. He was not only a man.
Well, I can certainly verify that.
He was extremely stimulating to everybody whom he met and who met him. Very stimulating. And one could never leave a discussion with Kraft Ehrike without thinking for oneself, for heaven's sake, I have to do more, I have to work harder, I have to do more. And here are so many ways where one can do something. I have to do more.
Well, I had the pleasure of having Dr. Ehrike present some lectures to my courses in the future back some 10 years ago, and I can certainly verify what you say. Mr. Dannenberg, what are your memories of Dr. Ehrike?
Well, I particularly would like to give Dr. Ehrike credit for the use of liquid hydrogen. In fact, I think that's one of the reasons that he finally left the von Braun team, that he went to San Diego and joined the General Dynamics Corporation so that he could work on the Atlas. And he was really the one who started the Centaur upper stage project, which for the very first time used liquid hydrogen. Of course, it was known that liquid hydrogen would be a real good perfect propellant, known by Professor Obert. He wrote quite a bit about it in his book. Von Braun knew it. But apparently even von Braun was reluctant to go that big step. He went the big step into liquid oxygen. But he apparently didn't want to go into liquid hydrogen. And Ehrike thought that's one of the things that should be done. And he pursued it. He was project manager of the Centaur project for many days. And I really give him credit that NASA finally was ready to use liquid hydrogen for the upper stages of the Saturn V, even the upper stages of the Saturn 1B. Use 1 and 1B both use liquid hydrogen. And of course, even today, the main propulsion system of the space shuttle uses this kind of propulsion system that was introduced by Ehrike. So I fully have to agree with you. He had good ideas, plenty of them, and never once in a while he even got to introduce one and make it a permanent part of our space program.
Dr. Stuhlinger, you mentioned that at Peenemünde, the topic of satellites was sometimes discussed. I know that all space historians have said that really it was forbidden to discuss the space implications of your technology at Peenemünde. But no state can forbid the imaginations of the human mind. And to what extent do you recall yourself and your close colleagues really imagining the future of space flight at that time in history? And what was your sense of the schedule to which we would move into the cosmos via your technology?
Dr. Tarter, you are right when you say that it was forbidden in Peenemünde to talk about space. It was, and Dr. von Braun did not always remain behind these limits, and he paid for it by being jailed, as you may know, and as has been documented amply in history. He was spent 14 days in jail because he remarked at one time, it was even in the evening party, that actually men and the work he was doing and his team was doing was actually for space flight and for later flight to the moon and to Mars. So we had to be extremely careful. But you know, a man cannot refrain from doing sometimes something which is forbidden. So we talked about space once in a while and about satellites and we did a little figuring, calculating. However, it was taboo for the immediate time, for the immediate presence at that time, for the present time. We did, when I say we, I should say many of us. Of course, there were many people in Peenemünde, about 10,000, and they were not exactly the same in their mental makeup. However, many of us did think quite a bit of the application of rockets for space flight. And for us, the Peenemünde time and the Peenemünde event was a first step, not to build a machine for war, but the first step to build a rocket that would permit us to go into space, to open that gate and to expand human life beyond the narrow limits of this Earth. You may recall that the military director of Peenemünde, General Dornberger, he said, he was actually von Braun's boss, and he said at the time when we had our first launching of in A4 in October 42, he said, "Gentlemen, today the spaceship of the future has been born."
Right, I recall.
And that should indicate to you that we really did think of space and of space flight. Now, if you should ask, did you anticipate that we would go into space that soon? I would have to say no. We hoped for, but we did not think that it might be possible. We hoped for very much and were longing for it. But at that time, particularly in the wartime, you know, with the war raging all around us, I think we would not have been bold enough to say that in 25 years, Efe Peenemünde will be on the moon.
Right. Well, could you give us some of your bolder visions of what might be in the next 25 years? Do you expect as many big surprises as we've had in the past 25 years?
There will be accomplishments, I'm certain. They will perhaps not be as tremendous and outstanding in the public eye as going to the moon. You know, there's just one moon and we made it, we went to it, and then there's no more moon. But there is a planet Mars, which has a lot of attraction for space travelers and for scientists particularly. And I am among those optimists who believe that within the not too distant future, man will land on Mars. But it will be 25 years, I don't know. I hope so, maybe, probably so. The landing on Mars, on the other hand, will probably not be, will not have as huge a public impact as the landing on the moon, just because the landing on the moon was the first time a human being went out and landed on a neighbor in space. When we go to Mars, then people may say, well, moon, Mars, that's fine, that's not in the same direction. But I believe that this will be one of the highlights. And another highlight will, of course, come earlier. That will be the station, our space station, which is being planned now and built. I have no doubt that there will be a space station, whether it will look exactly as it looks now on the drawings which we see today is another question. But I'm sure that it will be there, and I'm also sure that it will not be the only space station. I think there will be at least one, probably two more, one by the Russians and one by the Europeans. I'm pretty sure of that.
Do you put much credence in the idea of large-scale space colonization? I know Mr. Dannenberg is a very active member of the L5 Society, and they are looking forward to the time that we may have thousands of people living in space habitats. Do you?
Dr. Tarter, I would by no means discount that. I could well imagine that this is how mankind and things are developing in the further future, but I believe that there will be a relatively large step in technology, in time, in money, between, say, having an expedition to Mars and having a large colony in space. Mm-hmm. I think that it is just it's a beautiful idea, of course, a brilliant idea, and would be awfully good to have this. But if you just think of how much it will cost to do that, and take these costs out of our GNP, our gross national product, there's nothing left. And I think that here is the real problem. We just can't give so much of our total budget, of our total financial possessions. We can just give so much to space and space colonization, and this will, I'm afraid, will not be enough to build a big colony, not soon.
Mr. Dannenberg?
I'm sorry.
He's one of the directors.
Well,
of the L5 Society. Do you have
I think in principle I agree with Dr. Sturinger. I think we have to show really that man can go out there and make money being out there. Mm-hmm. Make it really an economic venture, mm-hmm. something that pays for itself. Mm-hmm. If we look at these activities the way we look at the space station right now, being a government-funded project where the taxpayer practically foots mm-hmm. the bill for everything that's being done, I agree with you, I don't think it would even happen in that case. So I think we have to find ways and means of really using outer space for all kind of human endeavors that are of interest to humankind in general. And once that's the case, then I also agree with you, we probably will even have more than just three space activities, and every country which can afford it and which can support such a thing would probably want to go that way. We are now already, of course, far, far out. I would like myself to hear from Dr. Sturinger a little bit more about the near-term future. one of the major forthcoming space shuttle payloads will be the Space Telescope. And I know that you were involved quite a bit in the early concept of the telescope. Can you tell us a little bit what you expect the telescope to do? Maybe you can even tell us a little bit about its basic configuration, and particularly, again, what kind of information about space we hope to get from the telescope project.
Mr. Dunberg, I believe that for science-minded people who are interested in space, I believe that the Space Telescope is about the most beautiful and most challenging and most valuable science project that the space program enables us and has enabled us to do. The Space Telescope will primarily give us an opportunity to look into space more deeply, with much higher accuracy, and with other in other regions of the spectrum than we can do it from the ground. The Space Telescope will have a huge mirror, which will be not quite as big as the big mirror on Mount Palomar. It will be about half as big in diameter, but it will be big enough to give us a resolution of detail of objects in the sky, a resolution which is at least 10 times as good as the one we could obtain from even with the best telescopes from the ground, because of the atmosphere and the dust and humidity in the atmosphere. What we will find out there is, of course, not known. We do know that we will make great progress in a number of directions. We will, for example, learn far more about how the stars come to life, how they go through their personal development, how they die, how they produce their energy, how they get their energy out into space, how they interact with each other, how they build larger congregations of stars like clusters and galaxies. We will also learn about planetary systems around other stars. Our own star, the Sun, has a number of planets and many moons, and we believe that this is relatively frequent occurrence among the stars in the sky. In fact, we think that half or two-thirds of the stars have planets around them. We have not seen anyone for sure. There has recently been some news in the papers that another planet has now been discovered, which is quite likely and quite probable. In fact, as soon as we have the big telescope in orbit, I'm sure that we will discover more of such planets. Now, to some people, this may be only a very elusive scientific thing to discover other planets, but we must not forget that we have to learn far more about our own Earth and our own planets and our solar system than we know today, in order to better take care of our Earth under the danger of all we are doing to it, pollution and overpopulation and all of that. And we can learn more about our own Earth and about its future and its vulnerability by learning more about other planets and other stars. And this is a very practical aspect of space astronomy. The telescope which we are going to send up will have an accuracy far higher than the accuracy of the best telescopes on Earth, simply because on Earth we are all always hampered and limited by the atmosphere and by the earthly environment. The actual accuracies in stability and in directional delicate orientation, these accuracies are just tremendous, and they are mind-boggling for everyone who looks into that. On the other hand, it seems that it is possible to achieve these accuracies. All the experiments which have been made so far and the testing would indicate that one can really obtain the high levels of accuracy which one needs for the Space Telescope.
So you are really looking forward to the launch of the telescope, which I think is now scheduled for 1986.
Yeah.
And that certainly would be one of the major steps that are going to take place in outer space in the next few years. What would be the relationship of the telescope to the space station? Can you elaborate on that very briefly?
there will not be much of an immediate relationship. The telescope will be launched by the shuttle. It will be put out into its own orbit. And then one has to leave it alone. In fact, it will be switched on only after the people have left. And it's just on its own because the presence of people or of an environment which may be a little bit changed or contaminated by the presence of human habitat. The environment of that kind would be dangerous and it must be avoided. Mm-hmm. So the telescope must be left alone as much as possible. And there are only radio links going up and down between the telescope and the Earth.
So it will not be attached to the space station?
No.
Do you see that possibly some repair work could be done from the space station instead of bringing it back to Earth?
It may be that one wants to exchange some components, sensors and some electronic parts once in a while, and this can be done quite easily, relatively easily, by having people go up with a shuttle, going over with a little transport vehicle to the telescope, doing the interchanging of the components and bringing them back to Earth through the shuttle to the ground. Without space station. I think the space station will be needed for many other things, but I think not for the space telescope.
So in that case, there will not be much assistance to the telescope project
from the space station.
That also means, of course, if the space station, for one reason or other, should not get approved, it will not have any detrimental effect on the telescope.
No.
So these two can go on independently. Yeah. Now, of course, it also brings up the question, many people believe that NASA does too much in the area of manned spaceflight. The telescope is, of course, in the other area, which some people refer to as unmanned or automated spaceflight. What is your thinking in that area? Do you think NASA is pretty much on the right track? Do we do enough in both areas? Or do you think a little bit more should be done in the automated spacecraft area?
I would love to see much more work being done in the automated and scientific area, but I am, on the other hand, I am very fond of manned space flight too. I would simply say that more should be done in the total scope of the program. We should have a larger program. We should be willing to spend more of our possessions here in this country on the exploration of space, manned and unmanned.
Dr. Stuhlinger, you've been very active in the field of astronomy. You were very instrumental in setting up the observatory here on Mount Sano, weren't you, several years ago? Could you give us some feeling for the progress that might be made in radio astronomy over the next few decades, and particularly the very exotic project of perhaps searching for extraterrestrial intelligence?
The radio astronomers are looking forward toward space-based receiving stations, rightfully, because they may have a good opportunity of locating their radio receivers in a way that can just not be done on the Earth. One of them would be on the rear side of the Moon. They could be sitting there with a huge radio telescope and look out into space with the Earth being shielded by the rest of the Moon. And then they would not be disturbed by any of these many, many radio signals which our Earth is transmitting out all the time. And they could utilize their far higher level of sensitivity. The other application would be to have two radio receivers at the same time at large distances, maybe in a huge orbit around the Sun even, and one of them sitting on one side of the Sun and the other on the other side. And between them, there would be a very large baseline. They would have to be in contact with each other or even with the Earth or with another object so that their signals can be tied together. But then because of that large space, this large space between them, they could obtain an angular accuracy of locating sources of radio emission. They could do that with an accuracy which is entirely unparalleled on anything we could do from Earth. The angular accuracies which one could obtain, they are thousands and thousands of times better than the best we could obtain from the Earth. And there are tremendous possibilities for radio astronomy. Now, whether they will be able to pick up signals from other beings is, of course, a very good question, and that does not only depend on the sensitivity of our instruments, it also depends on whether such signals are being transmitted from some time at some time and from some place. And here, I think the best answer anybody can give is, we do not know. We do not know. On the other hand, this is, scientifically speaking, an extremely challenging situation. If we don't know, we have to find out. And of course, we are there in a dilemma. We want to find out and would like to look and do all kinds of things. On the other hand, it just cannot cost more than a certain amount of money, because we cannot spend out of the funds which we badly need for many things on Earth, cannot spend out of them just listening out and listening whether we may have a voice from space.
That would truly be one of the most awesome findings in the history of science.
It would.
Were to discover
I'm pretty sure that one will, in the course of time, one will find signals. I'm quite sure of that. But they may come in as a kind of chance detection and chance discovery. Maybe if one just looks at astronomical objects in space, one may just by incident receive something which can be recognized as being produced by intelligent beings.
Changing the subject just a little bit, today we're engaged in a great national debate concerning the role of the military in space and space militarization. Some people call it the Star Wars program and so forth. What are your thoughts on these issues? Could you summarize a few of your basic thoughts on these issues that confront the public today?
Dr. Tata, my basic attitude and position here is the following, and it's not my idea, it has been thought in the same way for thousands of years. The best guarantee for peace is to have a strong defense. Strong defense posture. That is the best guarantee to keep the peace, to guarantee the peace. This is how, by the way, the V2 project in Germany was begun. It was begun actually in 1929, long, long before Hitler came and the Nazis came in 1929, because the army said we have to build up a strong defense post and strong defense capability, and here's a possibility. Now, this country does exactly the same. We have built and are building military rockets just in order to be ready to defend ourselves. And I think that there's no doubt in my mind that this is a very important and fully justified situation. And from that standpoint, I think it is correct to utilize modern technology wherever we can get it to strengthen our defense capability. Now, you asked about the Strategic Defense Initiative. This is very specifically an effort to counter one particular kind of attack, namely attack from another country, which is a few thousand miles away, by intercontinental ballistic missiles. And the idea is that one can detect and destroy these missiles at the time when they come up over the horizon or even earlier. Now, this is a beautiful idea, and it would be excellent if it could be made to work. I think what we should do at the present time, and I am speaking now as a physicist, as a scientist, and not as a defense department member, of course. I think what we should do is to develop, to look into and to develop the basic technology for this kind of a system and see how far we can go before we come to the limits of the laws of physics and the engineering feasibility. We should make very clear that we do not go beyond these bounds, because if we do, then we waste our money. You know, we should always try to stay with our efforts and with our developments within those things which are physically and technically feasible and possible. But then there is another thought which is quite different on the same subject, and that is the following. This particular initiative would counter one specific kind of an attack, namely the attack of long-range vehicles which come from a long distance. This is certainly a potential danger in today's world, but it is not the only one. There are so many other ways how a war can start. other ways, other places, other methods, other kinds. And I think a country should have, in order to keep its defense strong, it should have a defense capability for all of these other possibilities also. So I think we should not fall victim to the danger that we put all of our eggs into the one basket of the long-range missile countermeasures. We should rather be very sure that we distribute our means and our capabilities to the many areas of defense which must be considered and which must be established and built up. And in these areas there are a number of techniques which we have to develop and systems which we have to develop which would not fall into the category of long-range missiles.
You mentioned that there is no greater insurance against war than a strong defense, but could you comment briefly on what might be the moral and the ethical sort of implications for the scientist and the technologist to be sure that the science and technology that they provide to a country does not come to be used as a weapon of offense rather than defense?
Dr. Tarter, you touch here on a problem which is an extremely difficult one, extremely severe one. Many people have tried to give answers, but many of those who come up with an easy and quick answer have not thought it out profoundly and carefully. I don't know. I don't know. Of course, everybody, and particularly the scientists, love peace. I cannot emphasize that strongly enough. They love peace for themselves and for the rest of the world, and they would like to do all they can to keep it. Now, if a scientist simply said, well, from now on I will not develop electronics further, or computers, or communication systems, or rocket systems, if he said that, I don't know whether he would really contribute something to peace. I don't know. I cannot answer that, probably not. But it's not something that can be answered easily. On the other hand, the responsibility to maintain peace is not only with the scientists, it's with many, many people. It is with all the people together, particularly with the politicians and those who have an influence on the way our political fate and our fortunes are shaping up and forming up.
Do you think young scientists and technologists need perhaps more education in the political sciences, in ethics, philosophy, which guide the use of technology?
I think the most important one would be in ethics, in fields of ethics. I think that would be the most important one. Now, how that can be done, there are many possibilities, and I think we should not shy back from that responsibility. The older ones. We should not feel that we are helpless there. I think there's no effort will be lost which helps to bring about a better education in the direction of ethics and morals and of taking an attitude towards the world, towards the other people, towards mankind, which helps to stay away from war-like interactions.
Right. All right.
Along the same lines, do you think we still have a chance to keep military activities out of space activities, or have we gone over that threshold already and space is going to be a military activity in one way or another?
I think we are far beyond that point of decision already. Not only we in this country, but in other countries even more so. Now, on the other hand, there is one way of looking at it. I'm personally convinced that if we had not had long-range missiles and this threat of immediate retaliation, if we had not had that, I'm sure we would have the Third World War on our hands now. I think that was prevented so far. It's now 40 years since the last one. That has been prevented only because of that deterrent force of the long-range vehicles, missiles.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's the military rocket, as controversial as that may sound, but it has a peacekeeping function, and I'm sure it has exercised that function already.
We've been handling some very weighty questions here. There's been one question on my mind for some time that's not very weighty, but of interest. I think James A. Michener, who wrote the novel Space, which was a national bestseller back a year or so ago, referred to you many times in his novel. In fact, you were one of the two people that referred to by name. He spoke highly of you in your imagination of the future and your contributions to the past. Why is it that he selected you as a real person rather than fictionalizing you as he did so many others? Do you have any idea?
Dr. Tata, I don't know. We have known each other personally a little bit, so when he talks about the book before he wrote it, and it may be that this had to do with the fact that he named me by name. But other than that, I don't know. I cannot answer the question.
What we've done when we've come to the end of these interviews in the past is to try to give you a chance to take 2 or 3 minutes to summarize what you hope the contribution of your life has been and what your fondest hopes are for the future of mankind would be. Do you think you could give us some of your thoughts on that for these last few minutes?
Dr. Tata, I feel very privileged that I have been able to be a part of that historical chapter in our lives where men began to reach out into space and to leave the Earth and look at it from some distance. It's really a great experience, and it's only our generation who could have this experience for the first time, you know, at least our time, our half century. And I'm very grateful and feel privileged for having been able to see that and be with that development for a number of years, and even to perhaps contribute here and there a little bit. I am quite certain that we are in space now to remain there. I think we will not withdraw from space. I think we will be there, and it will expand more and more for all times to come. We will certainly develop more capabilities, more ready and quick capabilities to go into space and to come back and to live out there and to do a number of things, particularly materials processing. We have not talked about this in this discussion here, but I think that's a very important activity for the future in space, processing of materials and development and building of materials of all kinds which one cannot build under the gravity of the Earth. This will certainly be a very important thing. I also believe, and we come here a little closer to the space colony, mm-hmm. I'm quite sure that in not too distant the future, one can go maybe with Lindblad into orbit for some days or weeks and then come back to Earth, such as mm-hmm. one is going now to Norway or to the South mm-hmm. Pole with Lindblad and other companies. I'm quite sure that one will be able to do that for... if one can afford to pay the ticket, one can go up in space and enjoy the time there for some time. Then the large space colonies, I think, will be a matter of the further future, the more distant future. There will be a few more technologies being developed for space travel, and you ask me what I hope think my contribution could be. I like to hope and like to assume that one of the capabilities for the near future in space will be electric propulsion. The electric rocket, the iron rocket, is a kind of propulsion which has been developed to a high degree of perfection on Earth, but it has not really been applied yet in space. I hope very much that this will be applied in the near future, in the next couple of years, and I'm certain that it will be an important part of our total space capability. Electric propulsion has a few advantages over chemical propulsion for long time trips to planets and to asteroids and comets and wounds. For example, I would expect that before this century is out, I would expect that a vehicle powered by an ion rocket will have brought back a part of a comet, of the nucleus of a comet. This icy material which makes the comet nucleus will be brought back to Earth, I'm sure, with one of these vehicles. Uh-huh. It's one of the things I'm hoping over the next couple of years.
Well, most fascinating. I wish we had several more hours to talk about these possibilities of the future, but we're down now to our last minute of activity, and I certainly want to thank Dr. Stuhlinger for being our guest. I want to thank Mr. Dannenberg for helping me in this interview, and we want to thank both the Alabama Space and Rocket Center and the University of Alabama in Huntsville for making this interview possible.